Professor S. Lakshmi Narayan, who was moderating unofficially all through the session today. He's a professor of medicine in ACS Medical College. The topic is a case of hemolytic anemia. Please come, sir.
On my behalf, my junior resident, Dr. Archana will present, and I will sum up his history.
Good evening to everyone. I am Dr. Archana, working as junior resident in Professor S. Lakshmi Narayan and Sir Unit, and from IHS Medical College in Hospital. Before going to present, I personally thank my professor for giving this opportunity. Thank you, sir. And I am going to present an interesting case of what I mean hemolytic anemia. A 24-year-old female, Mrs. Rita, admitted on 17th March, has AMS complaints of reduced abdominal pain and additional vomiting for 3 days, and she had history of upper abdominal fullness and jaundice for 1 month. She had history of hyperuric and dark blood use, and no history of fever, no history of loss of appetite. And in past history, she had similar two episodes in the past 2 years, and no history of recurrent fever, no history of previous blood transfusion. Menstrual cycle is normal, and she is married at 15 years of age and delivers to her with a full-term normal delivery. And general examination, he is a lean individual, frail, and with normal temperature and mildly equipped with lemon yellow in color, and no significant dysphagmopathy. Blood pressure and pulse rate is normal. The picture shows the yellow tinge over the face and the serum. Okay. And systemic examination, cardiovascular and respiratory system is clinically normal, abdomen is soft, liver is not valuable, and spleen is enlarged 1.5 inch below the left parking margin, which is soft in consistency and mildly tender. No free fluid, and CNS is normal. So finally, we evaluate this case with the jaundice with splenomegaly without fever. So patient was admitted on 17th, 18th lab findings shows hemoglobin 7.5%, total count is 7000 cells, and differential count neutrophil 60%, lymphocytes 33%, eosinophils 2%. ESR is 80 mm per hour, which is great, and RBC is 3 million cells. PCR is 29%, NCR is 92.4 femtoliter, which is great, and MCH is 30.4 picogram, MCHC is 32.8, which is also great. The platelet is 180,000 cells. Platelet is 80 positive. And pressure is near, the RBC shows microcytic hypochromic anemia, and WBC is greater to normal. Ratio of hypochromic is great, 9.9%, normal reference is 0.22%. And serology for HBS antigen is negative, and serum free hypochromic level is reduced, which is 10 mg per deciliter, normal range is 50 to 150 mg per deciliter. The picture shows the features of microcytic hypochromic anemia. This is variation in size and shape of the RBC, and erythropoietylocytosis and erythrocyte cells, and increase in central paleness. This film shows the erythrocyte cells, which is a miniature RBC. It contains network of remnant RNAs and other cytoplasmic organelles. Next. During the examination, it shows the pale enough. Clear, glucose albumin is nil, and bile salt bile thickness is nil, the urine is positive, and microscopic examination is normal. Serum electrolytes are within normal limits, lipid profile is also normal, the RFT shows urea level is 23 mg per deciliter, creatinine is 0.7. We have done serially air function test. Initially, total bilirubin is raised to 5.2 mg per deciliter, and indirect bilirubin is 3.8. which is higher than direct bilirubin. After initiating the treatment, the bilirubin level is gradually reduced. In thus, from initial onwards, the liver enzymes are within normal limits. Next. Adoption of the abdomen shows liver is in normal size, and lean is enlarged in size, measures 4 5.8 into 5.7 centimeters as a uniform homogeneous pan-colour architecture. Other structures are normal. They have done the LDS injury with rates up to 1,273 international units per liter. The reference value is 200 to 400. After initiating the treatment, this value is reduced, but still it is increased 543 international units per liter. Then the pool test, both ETAC and ETAC is positive one initially. After starting the treatment also, still it is positive. And to do not SLE, we have done just for LE cells, which is negative. And to the malarial infection, we have done the QPCR test, which is negative. Next. In summary, a 24-year-old female with complaints of abdominal pain and jaundice, who was found to have anemia and splenomegaly on examination. So based on anemia, recurrent jaundice, splenomegaly, with normal liver enzymes and elevated serum bilirubin and LDH level, with increased reticular signs count with positive puncture, we diagnose this case as abdominal hemolytic anemia. So we started steroid tadalafil 1 mg/kg per day on 29th March. Patient is gradually improved and repeat HB shows 10 g/cm. So improvement in reduction of bilirubin is already shown on the slide. Next. So next we are going to discuss about theoretical part of hemolytic anemia. So the mean RBC lifespan is 120 days. So if less than 120 days, it means hemolysis suffers. So triad of hemolytic anemia is anemia, extravasic jaundice, splenomegaly. So it occurs through vasovasculitis and extravasculitis. So the extravascular features increased HB level, hemosiderinuria, very low are actually haptoglobin and methemoglobinemia. The extravascular features, lytic features are hyperbilirubinemia and jaundice. These are dominant features of extravasculitis. So, causes for hemolytic anemia, classes are inherited acquired. Inherited is because of external membrane defects such as hereditary spherocytosis, stromatocytosis, and hemoglobin abnormalities such as thalassemia and sickle cell disease, and metabolic defects due to enzyme deficiency, pyruvate kinase and GCSPD deficiency. In acquired classes are immune and non-immune. Immune includes autoimmune, allergic. Autoimmune classes are warm type, cold type, and drug induced. Allergen because of hemolytic transmission reactions and hemolytic disease of newborn or after bone marrow or organ transplantation. Next. In non-immune type includes mechanical, such as artificial valves, severe burns, extensive burns, and mass hemoglobinuria, membrane defects to paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, drugs such as sulfonamides and nitrofurantoin. Toxins include snake, viper venom, and formic acid poisoning. Next. So, autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Acquired disorder resulting from increased red cell destruction due to red cell autoantibodies. Destruction mainly occurs through various mechanisms, through macrophages and complement system. So macrophages where the places of macrophages are abundant is highly occurred, like spleen, bone marrow, liver. So complement system mainly intravascularizes. It is characterized by presence of positive DAP antiglobulin test, so DAP wound test. Placement, autoimmune hemolytic anemia, that's where it's one type, cold type, and mixed type. One type is more common, and mixed type is 8% only. It's mainly unacceptable. System is local asymmetrical. So, difference between one type and cold type is one type, the augmentation mainly occurs at 30 degrees Celsius. It is more common in middle aged females, and antibody is IgG mainly, and extravascular lysis. That is strongly positive, and the primary cause is idiopathic. Secondly, possible disorder due to drugs and other autoimmune disorders. Drugs include methylprednisolone, insulin, cephalosporins, and NSAIDs, quinine. Autoimmune disorders include SLE, CLL, and Hodgkin's lymphoma. In cold types, the presentation occurs less than 37 degrees Celsius. It's more common in invalids and also occurs in old age. The antibody titers IgM, mainly intravascular lysis. The wound is also positive. Primary cause is idiopathic. Secondary cause is mainly infection, Epstein-Barr virus, mycoplasma, and viral infection. And mainly occurs due to in old age, paroxysmal polar hemoglobinuria. That causes like tryptophan. So the warm type, it mainly due to antibody, the IgG type, or through complement activating system. The cause ranges from mild to chronic anemia to explosive and life threatening hemolytic crisis. So it usually represents with a short excess of anemia and jaundice. It often remittent relapse. It might be chronic stable anemia that is less than 8 grams per month, and spleen is often palpable. Infection or folate deficiency may lead to profound fall in HP level. So lab findings in warm papers, mainly reticulocytosis and spherocytosis, anisocytosis, polychromasia, punctate basophilia, neutrophil leukocytosis, and increased LDH level, free HBs raised, it suggests low intravascular lysis, and homeostasis fast with IgG is 37%. Sometimes the platelet counts also reduced because of antibodies produced against the platelet, that is called Ewing syndrome. So treatment for warm typhus, first we have to correct anemia by giving iron folic acid, then we have to start corticosteroids. It's 80% is effective. And double prednisone, 1 mg per kg per day, or injection methyl prednisone, 1 to 2 grams per day IV. So steroids mainly reduce production of red cell antibody and destruction of antibody coated red cells. So the treatment continues until the HP level is stable or the PCB level is stable. So if acute HP is controlled, we should tap up the dose. And initial dose happening at a rate of 5 to 10 milligrams per week. Next. If there is no response to steroids, we have to search. Next step is splenectomy. If the patient is unfit or fails to splenectomy, we have to give immunosuppressive drugs, so like carbidopa, cyclophosphamide. If there is a severe anemia, we have to give blood transfusion. Next. So in cold type, transferal fever, paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, which is self-limiting, disorder, supportive parent only. And cold agglutinin syndrome, it occurs in adults, chronic cold hemoagglutinin disease. It represents like acrosinusitis, Raynaud's phenomenon, mainly due to extral autoorganization and ganglion of the fingertips. The last point is spurious increase in MCV occurs. So the red cells agglutinin in cold or room temperature, and it's reversible after vomiting sample. And in this test, direct home stress is possible as complement CV. So treatment for cold type is, first we have to avoid exposure sports, that is keep in warm environment. CR, splenectomy and alternating agents are ineffective in cold type. If there is a severe anemia, we have to give blood transfusion, but blood should be warm and infused to warmer. Rituximab, that is anti-CD20 drug, this is successful in some cases. Thank you.
What do you have seen? Have you seen the paper?
Yeah.
Yeah, come. Professor Lakshminarayan was my teacher in Stanley Hospital in the 70s. So I was very happy to receive his phone call when he called me. Of course, I don't think I contributed much except I concurred with him. And, you know, he has, of course, a clinching point whenever you see a patient with anemia, with jaundice. Everybody thinks it's hemolytic anemia, as he said rightly with the undergraduate knowledge. And of course, the reticulocyte count is 9%, which is high. And you know, interpreting reticulocyte count, you know, you have to go by the degree of anemia. Sometimes it may not be appropriately elevated to the degree of anemia. So a normal reticulocyte count in an anemia patient is inappropriate. So if the bone marrow is adequately producing reticulocyte, in a case of anemia, which is hemolysis, it will be very high. So it's the order of 10%. But I can tell you, in the modern era of investigation, getting a correct reticulocyte count is the most difficult thing. It's not very easy to assess a reticulocyte count because it's very cumbersome and highly technician oriented. And I really congratulate them when they attempt to do the reticulocyte count. And LDH is a clincher. A very high LDH means hemolysis, but it will be very high in intravascular. It will be in this range in the extravascular. And of course, you have to do a direct Coombs test. The only comment I would like to make is the peripheral smear in an autoimmune hemolytic anemia, you should be considering this test. Plus, an autoimmune hemolytic anemia, we do direct Coombs test, and steroids have been given, and she has improved. And we see quite a lot of autoimmune hemolytic anemia in our clinical practice. And we always look for the first dictum when you see anemia, we ask for MCV. Of course, I've given talks here on anemia. You ask for MCV. Next question, you ask for reticulocyte count. The third question, you look for the peripheral smear. And of course, autoimmune hemolytic anemia can be associated with other autoimmune conditions. You should look for thyroid hypothyroidism. As Professor Chandrasekhar said, no, the thyroid hypothyroidism can be associated SLE as the doctor has beautifully presented with the primary or secondary. You should look for secondary causes. And you look for steroid in the first line of treatment. You always include folic acid and you always add azathioprine as an immunosuppressant. And if they are not responding, we go for other lines like anti-CD20 monoclonal antibody.
Thank you, Dr. Krishnan. Sir, that is really, that it is not associated with the gallstones. Usually hemolytic anemia, splenomegaly, because of the spherocytes, usually in my imaging wise, when we see a splenomegaly and jaundice, gallstones will be always associated.
Are you telling it is obstructive jaundice?
No, not obstructive jaundice.
But in our case, we did not.
That's what. It's not a case of
hereditary sclerosis. This is a disease. Whenever you see spherocytes in the peripheral smear, you should look for direct Coombs test.
Yes.
If it's DCT positive, it's autoimmune. If it's DCT negative, then you look for hereditary spherocytosis. And gallstones are more often associated with hereditary spherocytosis.
Sir, you mentioned about this star theater business. They seem to use steroids. How come this patient did not improve with steroids?
I don't know what they use. Whether they use steroids or not, they usually use herbalism. So I am not competent to answer your question, sir. Because I don't know what treatment they follow.
Siblings are all interested now, in this case.
They are children. How old are they? Pardon? 4 years and? No, the children. 4 years and? She has two children, no?
4 years and 7 years.
4 years and 7 years.
Sister.
She doesn't have any sister. She is only sister.
Usually it's not familiar. It's autoimmune. But you should screen for other autoimmune conditions.
The problem is how long to give steroids and how to find out what is the cause for this.
Usually it's primary. But
yeah.
You should look for lupus. Normally I add azathioprine because azathioprine will take another 2 weeks to kick in. Then I start tapering the steroid and then usually the patient will be on azathioprine for a long term, maybe 2 to 3 years. You can add other drugs like cyclosporin to spare from steroids. If they don't respond, then you go for anti-CD20 monoclonal antibody.
Now the hemoglobin is around 10.
You add azathioprine and leave the combination of steroid and azathioprine overlap for about 4 weeks.
they slowly start tapering the steroid.
This is the same dosage, 1 milligram per kg, 1 milligram.
Yeah, yeah. So they go up.
No, I'm asking the steroid.
Steroid is, if you get
1 milligram.
Yeah, 1 mg per kg plus azathioprine. Once azathioprine will take some time to add, after 4 weeks, you can start tapering the steroid 10 mg per week.
Very live scientific session we had. Thanks to again Professor Lakshmi Narayan. So please come to all sessions, sir.
We should invite Pa.
Being a member of IIM Chennai, Madam, welcome. We will be very happy to see you, sir.
Thank you.
Now the next topic is the politically sensitive and the media hype that is swine flu by Dr. V. Seshadri. Yes. Senior consultant physician from Sundara Medical Foundation. Sir, please come, sir.
Hi, thanks for inviting me. Actually, I am a member of IMA Ambathur Rauti. Most of all, from Sundara Medical Foundation, we are attached to Ambathur Rauti. First, I must thank Dr. Chandrasekhar for calling me. The thing is, as we said, it is politically born. But the only one thing is, it's an alarm. The H1N1 is now and then crops up and creates an alarm in both for the doctor as well as for the patient. The worst thing is, now the period is where some of the students and everything are going abroad. So last 3 weeks, we are flooded with asking for the anti-H1N1 vaccine to be inoculated. That's a story. Next slide. Yeah, the prevalence. See, this is the one, the latest prevalence. If you look on the right side, the Tamil Nadu also has shown a prevalence more towards the western side. But the number of cases so far for this season, the so-called influenza season starts from somewhere in November and then ends up in somewhere in April, has been around incidence has been 1,000, and death is not that much very high. They are confirmed that it will be around 10. So actually we are having a second season. Next. Now, it is caused by a swine, the influenza virus. Commonly we have A and B. Now this is A. They are related to this in swine influenza lineage. Now, throughout the world, there is no difference in the type of the influenza lineage. That means the characteristics are same. So any vaccine prepared in one place can be used in another place. Okay? Now, this has a special target towards the pulmonary area, starting from the sinuses, the throat, as well as the spine. These are not increased affinity, or most of the other organs involvement are secondary. So the level of pulmonary replication has been higher. The 2009 year is named because that is the time that everyone of us woke up to this type of virus. So the H1N1 virus is named as 2009 H1N1 virus. Then let us hear that. Now, we have always been in the paper and everywhere we are saying as the virus has gone into mutation, because this nowadays is not showing that amount of virulence. But no, there has not been a mutation of the virus has been noticed. Next. Now the epidemiology, for all practical purposes, it's an acute and self-limiting. The younger age group are more involved. Why the old people are spared is, probably they have been got exposure previously itself and have developed a sort of immunity. So that may be one of the reasons. The rate of illness in a group population means approximately 10% of us can always get infected in a